Not me or you, Robbie. Me. We'll figure out. Can you hear me now? It wouldn't be a regular Sunday if we didn't have some technological failure, right? We're so used to technology as part of our worship now. So hopefully that won't happen very often. If it does, we'll get it figured out. And we thank you for your patience in the meantime. We'll try that again. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It is good to see each and every one of you gathered here today as we come to worship our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus. My name is Amanda, and I have the great privilege to be the pastor here at Millington First United Methodist Church. If you're joining us for worship for the first time or the first time in a while, we are so very grateful that you are here today, and we pray that you will receive God's peace and grace as you join in these moments of praising our Lord, of offering prayer, of hearing God's word read and proclaimed. If you're visiting with us or you haven't been here in a while, we would be so very grateful if you would take the tear-off sheet from our bulletin and use it to record your attendance, as well as to offer us updated contact information. That way, we can send you a note this week to thank you for your presence here and to build a connection and relationship to see what questions you might have about our community of faith. As we prepare for worship today, I have a few announcements I'd like to share with you about what's happening in the life of our church. And this week, there is a lot going on. This Wednesday at both noon and 6 p.m., we'll be hosting a Bible study discussion group around our Good Enough Lenten study. We're reading together through Good Enough by Kate Bowler, a devotional this Lenten season together as a congregation. And on Wednesdays, both at noon and 6 p.m., we're going to join together to discuss our insights on the book as well as connect some of what we've been reading to Scripture. I hope that you'll have the opportunity to come and join us for this discussion as we dig deeper into where we see God in our lives right now. But even if you can't join us, I hope that you're keeping up with our devotional at home as we read together, and as that deepens our journey with Jesus this Lenten season. You'll also see on Wednesday evening, we have several new and continuing ministries meeting. Our choir will meet at 6 p.m. Our pulpit ministry will meet at 6 p.m. We also have a new opportunity through pickleball. If you have never played pickleball before, I think the best way to describe it is it's a match between tennis and table tennis and badminton and something in between. It's a fun sport that a lot of folks have enjoyed as a way to stay active even into your golden years. And so we have some very faithful and brave volunteers who have come forward and said they'd be willing to teach other people how to play pickleball. So we'll start that this Wednesday at 4:30. This is a great opportunity for the whole family to come out and have fun. Grandchildren and grandparents, parents and children, whatever you have in your household, you are welcome to join us for this moment of fellowship and fun and recreation. And we look forward to the fun that we'll have together. Also note that our Ladies' Day Out will be meeting this Friday as they head out to lunch to enjoy fellowship with one another. And this Saturday, for the first time now in 2 years, our Creation Care Ministry is hosting a seminar about the new advances of the Big Creek Recreational Development called Making Room for the River. We hope that you'll be able to join us this Saturday at 9:30 to learn more about what's happening right here in our community in Millington and how we can be part of it as well. The last announcement I have to share is that our Living Last Supper crew and acting class will begin meeting next Sunday for practice. They're going to meet every Sunday at 1 p.m. starting next Sunday for the Living Last Supper. Friends, with this announcement shared, and may we still our hearts on God's presence among us as we prepare for worship. label as we join together in our call to worship. We'll read responsively. I'll read in our regular print and we'll respond together in the bold. When disasters strike, where can we go?
God is always there.
When trouble surrounds us, whom can we trust?
Christ is always with us.
When life is hard, who can ease the load?
The Spirit is always there to sustain us.
Come, let us worship the God of our salvation.
God is here, and that is good enough.
Good morning, and thank you, Elizabeth, for that great prelude, the old, famous, Just As I Am. Our hymn of praise this morning is Gather Us In. That's familiar to us, so don't balk, all right? It is in our Faith We Sing on page 2236, or the words are projected on the screen. Elizabeth will play it through one time. Thank you.
together in our statement of faith. In this season of Lent, we are proclaiming the faith we share through the statement of faith from our brothers and sisters in the United Church of Canada. You can find this creed on page 883 in our hymnal or projected on our screen. Let us join together in proclaiming our faith with one voice as we say,
we are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, and life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen.
You may be seated as our children come forward for a children's message. Hello, friends. How are you today? Okay. We're going to stay down here. So, what stunts were you doing? Cheerleading? Yeah. Sometimes when you use those leg muscles a lot, they get sore, don't they? I heard you two had a very fun week. What did you do? You went to Disney? Was it awesome? Good. We're glad you're back here and safe. Today, I have planned for us a very special treat. We are going to get to plant these flowers. You know, I was worried we weren't going to get to plant them because all of the snow came down from the sky, and I wondered if it would kill all the flowers. I sure hope that nothing gets in our way today. You ready to plant some flowers? What's happening? Oh no, it's raining! We can't plant flowers while it's raining. We can. Do you see anything that could help us keep planting these flowers while it's raining? What's here? What's that? An umbrella. Okay. What can we do with the umbrella so that we could keep planting our flowers even while it's raining? What do you think? Put it over our heads. Can you help me do that? Let's see. Oh, there's one. Okay, will you hold it? Let's get under. Can you open that one? Our hair is going to get messed up. We better open it. Okay. Now, if you're not holding an umbrella, you can come get here close. Now, let's see. Even though it's raining, we can still plant our flowers, can't we? You want to help plant them? Yeah, come on. You can move the dirt on top. There you go. Yeah, here you go. Yeah, grab one. Very good. That's okay. Let's see. Let's stick it in there. Yeah, maybe just three of them will work, won't it? Okay. Wow. Okay. We still got to plant our flowers, didn't we? Okay, let's take our umbrellas down for a minute then. Thank you, Miss Aubrey Rainstorm. We are very grateful for you. Now, sometimes things happen that we didn't plan on, right? Did any of you plan on it snowing during spring break?
No. I didn't even know. I was walking
around
school and my dad said, why don't you have a jacket on? It's
literally
snowing.
I'm like,
what?
I know. We weren't ready for that, were we?
I didn't even know it was snowing because, like,
right, but you didn't know it was going to snow when you left school, when you went to school, did you? And in fact, on that day it snowed. We didn't need a jacket when the day started, but you sure needed one by the end of the day. And just like that's right. And just like we planned to plant these flowers, and then Aubrey, the rainstorm came and tried to rain on our parade. But you were quick thinkers, and you saw a tool that could help us still have fun and plant our flowers, even if it looked different than like what we planned, didn't it?
I already knew what we planned. I saw Aubrey
You saw it coming out of the corner of your eye. Very good. Very smart. That's okay. You know, sometimes things happen in our lives that we didn't plan on. We might have a really cool and awesome plan for how we think life should go. But then something happens and it's different. Like, maybe we really wanted to go swimming in our pool during spring break and then the snow came. Or maybe we thought today was going to be an awesome day at school and we're going to get to see our best friend and have fun, and then our best friend is sick and they're not at school that day. Or we plan to plant flowers and it snows and it rains. But you saw an umbrella and said we could still have fun even if it's different. God helps us see that even when life doesn't go according to our plans, God is still with us, and we can still move forward knowing that we are not alone. So these flowers, I'm going to help them get a little bit deeper in our planting bin, and we are going to keep them in our sanctuary during the season of Lent as we get ready for Easter, as a reminder that even when things don't go the way we planned, God is still here with us, and that makes life really, really good. So, will you pray by repeating after me as we give thanks to God for his presence, even when life goes off the rails? Let's pray. Dear God, we know you are here. When the sun is shining, or when the clouds are raining, or even when we have surprise snow. No matter what our plans are for life, we know your plan is greater. And so, God, we pray, help us trust that you are always here, no matter what. And because you are here, life is good and full of love. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, friends. You can head with Miss Debbie and Miss Audrey to Children's Church. I promise, no more rainstorms.
Our next hymn is our theme song for Lent, and it's called That's Enough for Me. It can be found in your insert. We learned it last week, remember? Elizabeth played it during offertory, so we all learned it last week. We're going to sing the first verse, then have a prayer, then sing the second verse. So you only have to sing it through one time right now. Elizabeth is going to play it through one time where it will jog our memories from last week.
As we come to this moment of prayer, we lift up our joys and concerns in that very same spirit. that God is here in this moment of prayer, and to be able to bring our concerns, our worries, our hopes, our dreams, our celebrations into God's presence is good enough. Just as our children led us in learning, life doesn't always go the way that we have planned. But that doesn't mean that God is absent from us. Indeed, God is very near. So as we prepare for prayer together, friends, what celebrations and joys, what concerns or cares do you bring into God's presence this day? Yes, Missy.
It's Daniel's 19th birthday today.
Oh, so very happy birthday to Daniel. He's working hard at the two churches. They get to enjoy him on Sundays. For those of you who don't know, Daniel Young, a member of our congregation, plays for two different churches in their worship band on Sundays. So we don't see him very often on Sunday morning, but we are grateful for the ways he is using God's gift, even on his birthday, to help usher others into the presence of God.
Amanda.
Yes?
One of my classmates was the SWAT team gentleman that was shot in the Covington standoff. He's home and he's doing well, but prayers for his recovery. He was shot in the arm and the torso. So.
What's his first name?
Gene. Last name Mulder.
Gene Mulder. We'll continue to pray for him in his recovery and give thanks that he's at home
and doing better.
Yes.
I'm so glad to see our friend Carol Miles here tonight.
Absolutely. What a celebration. We're glad you're here, Carol. Yes, Bill.
Be able to go up to St. Louis on my day off, and I get back in time to get grab Debbie and come to service.
Yes, when Bill walked in this morning, I said, you told us you weren't going to be here till Easter, but it's a special surprise to get to have you with us for worship. Thank you for your presence.
Once they had me work my day off, they had no driver, so I went in, so I was a blessing.
Very much so. Yes, Sunan.
I asked for special prayers for Owen this week. They get the telehealth communication on the 16th with the doctor to see what the news is.
We will be holding you and Owen in our prayers as you wait to hear. This past week, we had the opportunity to join together with the family of Jenny Ruth Fitzsimmons to celebrate her life and to offer her back into God's loving arms and presence in heaven. I'd ask that you continue to hold Jenny Ruth's family and friends in our hearts and prayers as they walk through this season of grief. And thank you to those who I saw there to surround the family with love and support. I know that your prayers are felt as a congregation, and they are very much appreciated. It's also good to see some other faces back here in worship for the first time in a while. We're grateful that you are able to join us in person and give thanks for the opportunity to join together as a congregation on this day for worship. Friends, if there are no other concerns or joys to be shared, will you join me as we go to the Lord in prayer? Let us pray together. God, you are our loving guide and the protector of your children. As we come together for worship today, Lord, we come into this place recognizing your presence. But Lord, you remind us that your presence doesn't only live here in these four walls, but that you meet us and you walk with us every moment of every day. And so as we place our cares and concerns, our joys, our celebrations into your hands, Lord, we bring these prayers before you, knowing that you have heard us, knowing that you listen to your children when we call out to you, and trusting that you are already weaving grace and mercy, healing and peace into the lives of those who we've lifted to you this day. Lord, too, we pray to feel a fresh wind of your Spirit as we join together for worship, that we might hear the message you have prepared for us and being strengthened by our worship together, by the love we experience in community, that we might go out into the world to share your love with others. Lord, as we'll hear in Scripture today, when Jesus began his walk toward Jerusalem, he knew the journey could cost his life. And Lord, we confess that when we, as your disciples, cannot see the road ahead, we are often tempted to turn back instead of trusting the path you lay before our feet. Lord, when Herod threatened to kill Jesus, Jesus remained with the people, unafraid, casting out demons and healing the afflicted. And yet, Lord, when trouble comes to us, we are tempted to run away and protect ourselves rather than remain with those who need our help. God, in this season, we remember that as Jesus faced the cross, he longed to gather the people, his people, your people, just as a hen gathers her brood beneath her sheltering wings. And so forgive us, Lord, for when we fall short, when we are not willing to take shelter in your loving arms. But help us hear your word of forgiveness today. Help us remember that you reach out to us with love, guiding us along the way. That as we turn to Scripture and study and pray, you are conforming us into the very image of Christ. It's in his name that we pray, as we join together in the prayer he taught us to say, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we sing our second verse, will our ushers please come forward for the offering?
Immediately following our hymn, in the second verse, we're also going to move into our offering time, and the chancel choir will be singing Loving Spirit. The words will be projected on the screen. Also, it can be found on the 2-1-2-3.
In this community and throughout the world. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
please stand for the doxology? Chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. After teaching about the kingdom of God, Jesus encounters some religious leaders along the way who seek to offer him a warning and guide him to safety. And we join today to hear his response. Again, I'll be reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 13, starting at verse 31 until the end of the chapter. At that time, some Pharisees approached Jesus and said, "Go, get away from here, because Herod wants to kill you." Jesus said to them, "Go tell that fox, 'Look, I'm throwing out demons and healing people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will complete my work. However, it's necessary for me to travel today, tomorrow, and the next day, because it's impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those who were sent to you, how often I have wanted to gather your people just as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. But you didn't want that. Look, your house is abandoned. I tell you, you won't see me until the time comes when you say, 'Blessings on the one who comes in the Lord's name.'" This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you join me in a moment of prayer? Will you pray with me and will you pray for me? God of grace, we hear in this story of Jesus' deep desire to gather us, the chicks of your flock, the sheep of your fold, under his sheltering wings of love and grace. Lord, in the many places in our lives where we experience pain or grief, help us remember that you are there, always offering us shelter and mercy. Lord, by that same mercy and abundant grace, I ask now that you would draw me beneath the shadow of your wings and cross, that what is heard today are not my words but yours, and what is felt in all of our hearts are not our own desires but your will, O Lord, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I wonder if Jesus cried as he looked over Jerusalem in the passage that we read today from Luke's Gospel. I wonder if big, soft, salty tears streamed down his cheeks as Jesus gazed toward the holy city, a place that had represented God's presence to God's people, and yet a place where he saw little to no evidence of God's peaceable kingdom. No, instead of being a place that embodied the heaven of God's justice and mercy on earth, this was a place that killed prophets, the messengers of God's word. This was the place Jesus knew his journey would end in tragedy. Jerusalem, the city whose name means peace, would be for him a place of violence, of betrayal, of death. Luke doesn't say so, but it's hard for me to imagine Jesus uttering these words without tears in his eyes. Remember, he spent the past 3 years of his life doing nothing except sharing God's love, teaching about God's kingdom, inviting people around him to turn back to God with all of their hearts and to experience new life. But it feels like that nearly each and every moment, people gather in crowds to listen to him, but most don't change their lives. Religious leaders like the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they're suspicious of him and his mission to share God's love. Political leaders like Herod are threatened by him and the power that he holds. Even his closest disciples, his most intimate friends, sometimes they don't understand him. So can we understand Jesus's sorrow, his frustration as he cries out, "Jerusalem, people of God, city whose name means peace, all I wanted for you was to offer you protection in the shadow of my wings. But you didn't want that." What else could Jesus do but weep? I often wonder, if someone else in Jesus' circle had known what was coming in Jerusalem, if they had understood that Jesus would suffer and die, but ultimately be raised to new life through the miracle of resurrection, and that this act of God's powerful love would bring forgiveness and salvation to the whole world, if someone else knew that all of that was coming, what would they have said to Jesus in this moment? I can't help but imagine that someone might have said something like this: "Jesus, I know you're disappointed and you're hurting, but imagine the good things that are just around the corner. Yes, this feels hard and heavy now, but it won't really matter in the end, right? Because God's going to make it all right anyway. So dry your tears, Jesus. It's going to be okay." Now, if someone had said something like this to Jesus in the moment, I'm sure they would have been full of good intentions. They would have meant well, but still, can you hear how very cruel, how uncaring those words might have sounded to Jesus? He is lamenting, bringing his sorrow in front of God. He is grieving over his disappointment that the people are not responding to his message of God's love, that the people are not choosing peace and mercy in their everyday actions. Jesus knows that redemption and new life for God's people, that waits on the other side of the cross, and yet that doesn't erase the suffering, the pain that he'll have to walk through to get there, even when he chooses to face that journey out of love for us. I imagine that it might happen this way because as people of faith, we don't do lament very well. We can be uncomfortable about being honest about our disappointments, especially with God. We try to wallpaper over the cracks of our lives with phrases like, "it'll be okay," or "everything happens for a reason," because in the end, we are uncomfortable with suffering. Suffering brings up big questions that we'd rather avoid. Questions like, if God is good, then how can life sometimes be so bad? And where is God when you pray and ask for help, but it doesn't come? Why didn't God answer? Questions like that, and illness, and grief, and suffering, these are all hard things to reconcile with our faith. Broken marriages, cancer diagnoses, war and violence, these things, they just don't feel like they belong in a world that was made by a God who is good. And sometimes in our frustration and trying to make sense of the existence of evil in the world, along with our faith in the goodness of God, sometimes we rush to defend God with words that more often end up doing more harm than good to people who are already suffering, including ourselves. But what if our attempts What if our attempts to try and control our lives with explanations for suffering, what if that actually ends up putting a wall between us and God? What if our insistence in quickly figuring out the good that will come out of the bad means that we actually miss the beauty of this promise, that when the world falls apart, God meets us in the rubble of our lives with his presence? In the gospel lesson today, Jesus is offering us another way. In response to his own disappointment and hurt, Jesus first acknowledges his sorrow. He takes time to mark his grief. When all he has ever wanted is to spread his wings of love and mercy over people, and yet things don't seem to be going according to that plan, Jesus doesn't shrug his shoulders and say, "Oh well, I guess I should just trust God more." Yes, Jesus will walk forward, trusting in God as he always has done every step of this journey so far. But first, in this fragile and vulnerable moment of pain, Jesus is brutally honest about his disappointment. Maybe Jesus' response to be honest about disappointment is really what you and I need in our lives. What if before we move to try and fix what we are feeling with words of faith, we just simply acknowledged the truth of our reality? We feel hurt because sometimes life is painful. We feel sad because sometimes life is tragic. We feel angry because sometimes life is unfair. Kate Bowler, the author of Good Enough, the devotion book that we're reading through together this Lent, she writes this: "You are okay to feel what you feel. We need freedom to acknowledge the brutality of life without minimizing or pretending or justifying. We need not rush to defend God or delude ourselves. It is terrible and it is happening." When Kate was first journeying through her own cancer diagnosis and subsequent treatments, she asked Father James Martin, who is a Jesuit priest, about how to pray in the awful and difficult seasons of life, the seasons that come with pain and disappointment and grief. Father Martin said this to Kate: "Prayer begins with acts of unbridled honesty. All of the good things that can come out of prayer, things like finding peace, like trusting in God, like experiencing connection with the Holy Spirit and the love of other faithful people, those things are really only possible when we are first radically honest with God in our prayers. God, this feels like too much. I'm not sure I can make it. God, why is this happening? It feels so unfair. God, where are you? I'm looking for signs, but it's hard to see you moving. God, I know you are good, but I don't see evidence of that in the world today." The more that we can freely acknowledge what we are experiencing, the reality of our lives and world, the more that we can see the reality that God meets us in all of life, even the times when all we can see is rubble and devastation. And in that moment of honesty, I believe, I trust, I know we will experience the beauty of God's loving and faithful presence even there. You don't have to look very hard right now to find pain or grief or violence in the world. Right now, every day on the evening news, every morning as we scroll through our Facebook news feed, we see people's lives literally crumbling into rubble right before our very eyes as we watch with pain and sorrow the nightmare of war unfolding in Ukraine. As we hear reports of Ukrainians fleeing their homes by hundreds of thousands, a home torn apart by a war that they did not ask for, as we wonder how we might respond if suddenly our reality included sending our children to school with their blood type pinned to their shirt, as we shudder to watch what's happening. We might be tempted to look away from the suffering, to wallpaper over the crack of our world and war, because it's hard to watch. We might be tempted to turn towards complaints closer to home, like the rising gas prices or the falling stock market, and push the pain half a world away out of our sight. But if we come before God honestly in prayer, if we lay our lament for the war in Ukraine before God, if we name the evil of war for what it is, if we pray for God to intervene, to gather the people of the world under God's wings of mercy and protection, then I believe we can begin to see the beauty that God is weaving even among the heaps of ashes and the piles of destruction. Fred Rogers, who we lovingly call Mr. Rogers, once told a young boy who asked him where to look for hope in a scary world. Mr. Rogers said this: "When I was a boy and I would see scary things in the news, my mother would say to me, 'Look for the helpers. You will always find people who are helping.'" Since the Russian invasion of Ukraine began 2 weeks ago, there are helpers from even our corner of the world rushing to offer aid and comfort and relief. 2 weeks ago, as the first reports of war broke on this side of the ocean, St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital has helped to evacuate 400 Ukrainian children with cancer, help those children get to other places in Europe where they can continue their treatment without the threat of bombs or gunfire. Dr. Aja Avlik, who is part of the team leading this effort, connected this work to St. Jude's guiding mission. She said, "We strive to take care of children with catastrophic illness, and what is more catastrophic to children, to anyone, than war? Helpers, they may not end the war. They don't take away the real hurt and pain and suffering that happens, but what helpers do is that they remind us in the scary moments of life, we are not alone. As people of faith, helpers remind us that God is here. And because God is here, even in the rubble of life, we can offer our prayers of lament, of sorrow, of grief with hope. Hope that God can and God will bring love and peace. This past week, as I was scrolling through Facebook, I saw this video that brought beauty and hope to my day. It's a video of a woman leaving her home in Ukraine that has been bombed. But before she leaves her home, she stops at the piano in her living room to play one last song. This video is moving, and it's touching, and it's heart-wrenching. It's beautiful for its music and its hope, and it's full of terror and sadness and war. And yet, for me, it is a reminder that even in the rubble of our lives, God's beauty can and will show up. If only first we admit to God the brokenness that we see, and then ask God to transform our eyes to look for hope.
Получается.
and bringing the rubble of our lives before God, and sitting with sadness and not sweeping unanswered prayers under the rug. Because in the midst of this sorrow and brokenness, we are not alone. The one who has felt what we feel, the one who has suffered the heavy burdens we carry, his name is Jesus, and he is unafraid to meet us in the heart of our pain. He reminds us that even when we cry because there is so much in this life beyond our control, even when we don't understand, and even as we pray to trust God more, Jesus reminds us the safest place to carry those prayers is into the hands of God. As we feel the shadow of God's wings covering us in mercy. The psalmist reminds us. The psalmist calls us to hope, saying, I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And so wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Friends, know that already God is offering us freedom from feeling alone and fixing what feels oh so wrong in this world. God is inviting us to let go of the need to be God so that we might recognize that God is with us, offering courage and difficulty. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Our closing hymn this morning is A Love that Will Not Let Me Go. It can be found on page 480 in the United Methodist Hymnal, or the words are projected on the screen. Please stand if you're able.
As a reminder that God's beauty still finds us even in the uncontrollable moments of life. Blessed are you who see things clearly, where struggle is everyone's normal. And while this life isn't shiny, it does come with superpowers. superpowers of ever-widening empathy and existential courage that get you back up after another fall, and a deepened awe of the beauty and love that can be found amid life's rubble. Like flowers that grow from the cracks in the sidewalk, these virtues blossom in you. And thank God for you. Blessed are all of us who struggle, for we are in good company and will never walk alone. And now may the God who loves all of creation, especially the ordinary parts, and Jesus, our companion along this crooked path of life, and the Holy Spirit, who strengthens and sustains us with grace, go with you, dwell with you, and give you joy.
God is still here, and somehow this faith is good enough.
Please join us in the choral benediction.
Something Beautiful can be found on page 394, or the words are projected on the screen. Thank you.